I was brought up in Australia, left it when I was about 20, something like that. So most of my childhood was there. And we're a tight little family. One of the interesting things I realized about it is that as I got older, I became interested in art and history and collected books on all of this. And in that whole time, I never went to a museum. Because I lived in a family that didn't do that kind of thing, and it somehow never occurred to me. Some very good museums in Australia, didn't see them. But somehow it settled in my mind over time that archaeology was something I was interested in, and kind of the Near East in general was my target. I was very influenced by some of the really quite good books on archaeology that came out, especially what was his name? Kerem, Gods, Graves, and Scholars. I guess in my early teens, I was inspired by that book, which had described, amongst other things, the burning of Babylon and some terrible siege. And so in a paddock between our house and someone else's house, an open field, I built Babylon using the walls of Babylon, using bricks, real bricks, just wall segments. And then dug a river around that and got the hose in it running. So it was very nice. No buildings, but still. And then I thought, well, the sack of Babylon, you know, they burnt the city. So I started a fire. And it was the height of the bushfire season in Sydney. And the paddock was covered with dry grass. So the fire went really quite well. I thought, this doesn't look good. And fortunately, an elderly lady who was our neighbor appeared at her fence with a hose and rapidly quelled the whole thing. So you see, archaeology had certainly got a hold on it. Dangerous, really. Then I went to Sydney University for undergraduate studies and discovered that they had a department of archaeology and a museum. First visit to a museum. So I studied there for a couple of years took a BA degree, which included Near Eastern, they call it Near Eastern archaeology, but the focus was really Cyprus, Neolithic and Bronze Age Cyprus, because that's what the two professors specialized in. And they excavated there every year. I never got a chance to join their actual excavations, but I really enjoyed the courses and the work and all this kind of thing. And so at the end of that, I said, I'm going to go, I said, how can I do more work like this? And they said, look, you know, we're not set up to do graduate level studies in these fields. And so your best bet is to go to London. So my family obligingly grub-staked me to go to London. And I remember being quite serious about going to different people representing different fields. And so although Egyptology presumably had some kind of a presence in my mind, I was also looking at other things, including someone who should be nameless, who said, why don't you go back home and do Aboriginal archaeology? Wasn't the thing I wanted to do. And somehow out of all of that, the Egyptologists at University College hit me hardest, made the biggest impression. And what I really liked was they said, you know, there's a big salvage campaign starting in Nubia, and we're collecting people to continue our excavations down there, and you'd probably be one of them, and so forth. So these are what I remember of the process of becoming interested in archaeology and taking it up as a career. Being a student in Egyptology at UCL was a very important experience for me, First of all, it meant that I, like other students, was involved with the Petrie Collection in University College London, which is a fantastic, not so much art historical collection, but an archaeological collection that it would be hard to surpass, really. And secondly, the faculty there gave the students full access to the collection. Basically, it was all in mostly in cupboards. Some of it was in exhibit cases, but it was mostly in cupboards. And those cupboards were unlocked in the day. And you could go in at any time and sit down, open a cupboard, and examine and record the ceramics that's there or the seals or whatever it might be. So it was a very open kind of situation. And I think I was also very fortunate in the Egyptologists who were there and who taught us. Brian Emery was the senior professor, and he went out to Egypt. Well, in those days, he went to Sudan. The British were in bad odor in Egypt, so he was working in Sudan, but on an Egyptian-style site. And he lectured on Egyptian archaeology and architecture. R.O. Faulkner,
oh,
that's
yes.
Who it is. He taught Egyptian. So we had like Gardner's ideas through the medium of one of his closest associates. And Anthony Arkop was more the archaeological side than the prehistoric side and the Sudanese side. So I learned a great deal from their teaching. And it also gave me access to the opportunities for working in the field in actually Sudan, because that's where they were. But at just about that time when I came in, Egypt was experiencing the big problem of the new dam at Aswan and the great reservoir it was going to create in the northern part of Nubia, which was part of Egypt. And so they said any institution who helps us in the salvage campaign is guaranteed a concession in Egypt after that. So you got the opportunity to work in the salvage campaign, and at the same time, Egypt was starting to open up in terms of accessibility to foreign sponsored projects. Professor Emery had a long-standing excavation going at the site of Buhen in the southern part of Nubia, which was part of Sudan politically. He typically took students out for multiple seasons sometimes, depending on how long you were working at being trained at University College. I spent, in fact, 3 seasons in the field with Emery, first in Sudanese Nubia at Buhen, and then in Egyptian Nubia, because the Egypt Exploration Society undertook to do a kind of archaeological survey of Nubia as a whole in order to assess what sites were still there and what was their nature and date and things of this kind. So I was working with Emery on a big monumental fortress site at Buhen, and then I also worked on the survey, so I saw a tremendous amount of Nubia and its archaeology and the ancient Nubian artifacts as well as Egyptian. And that's always been very important to me because I've always kept up a strong interest in Nubia. And I think if you become very familiar with a non-Egyptian culture, it's a great way of comparing what goes on in 2 geographically close nations and yet we're going on very different trajectories. And I'm not sure that, you know, all Egyptologists develop that kind of perception of the world outside of Egypt, and I certainly first Cyprus, Sydney, and then Nubia in the survey. I didn't see so much of what was going on overall. There were many projects in Nubia at that time, and also some gigantic conservation processes going on. In fact, many of the stone-built temples and even rock-cut temples that were left there by the ancient Egyptians when they had occupied the region were literally dismantled and shipped up to Aswan. Some stayed in Aswan, they were rebuilt. Others were given to institutions. Metropolitan Museum ended up with the Temple of Dendor, which is a great little monument. But I wasn't directly involved in that. My my most vivid memory is a test, how your senses kind of get jangled. While I was working in Nubia, I guess the third season, I received a letter from Fro Rini, who was then the director of the University Museum in Philadelphia. And they were looking to recruit an archaeologist to work in Egypt, an Egyptologist, but one who was worked archaeologically, which is what they wanted to get going again in Egypt. And he was also involved in the committees that organized the salvage campaign. And I wrote and said I was interested. And then I got a telegram while I was at Buhen, and it said, "I will be at Abu Simbel on such and such a day. Please meet with me, Fro Rini." So I did what you would do out there in the wilds of Nubia. I hailed a taxi in Wadi Halfa. He drove me to the frontier. We shook hands with all the frontier guards who could have cared less about us, and they waved us on into Egypt. So I finally ended up on the wrong bank, of course, to Abu Simbel, which I could see literally gleaming over there. And I said, "How do I get across?" And they said, "Oh, this little old man in his canoe will take you across." That's what he does. So we went over, and there was a houseboat. There was Rainy. We sat down together. We talked for probably a couple of hours. And then he said, "Well, it was interesting to meet with you. We'll be in touch." So I went back to Buhen. And to this day, I cannot remember a single thing that I said or he said. But we talked at length. A few weeks later, I got another letter or telegram from him saying, "We'd like you to consider taking our position at Penn." Life for Egyptologists, especially archaeological ones back then in the 60s, earlier part of the 60s, was kind of very different from what it was now. First of all, there weren't that many Egyptologists who were interested in an archaeological career as distinct from epigraphic or philological. And secondly, it was a very small community, so people got to know you and get a good or a bad idea of what you were like. And so I think that all contributed to the fact that, you know, I hadn't finished my PhD, which I was actually writing at Cambridge, not at University College anymore. I was kind of relatively young and untried, but there was Emery to say, "He's worked out well with us. He'll probably work out well with you." As this incredibly junior figure, I was offered this position at Penn, and I accepted it. That was my most memorable contact in Nubia. But the experience of the archaeology was, in a formative sense, very important to me, and kind of gave me a model for the future. So I would try to deal with things and with students and things of that kind. I guess that after my work in Nubia and my studies at University College in London, working at the University of Pennsylvania and the University Museum was the next major impact on the way I thought about Egypt, the way I thought about field research could be carried out in Egypt, and how you would present Egypt to students. Because at Penn, there were a relatively large number of students, some of whom wanted to specialize in ancient Egypt, others were just interested in taking courses on it. So right from the get-go, I was busy teaching students at various levels. My faculty appointment was in what was then called the Department of Oriental Studies, where we had Judaica, Southeast Asia, all kinds of different fields. And that was an interesting part of the experience. But my main sphere of activity was the University Museum itself, which, as probably many people know, has a very fine Egyptian collection, both archaeological and art historical. So it was really quite an impressive collection to be in contact with and to be actually in charge of, because junior as I was the permanent appointee. We had some distinguished senior Egyptologists who came and taught some courses. there was some senior Egyptologist who came to teach language, which I did not teach. Kelly Simpson was there for a semester or an academic year, and also Yaroslav Cherny, another very famous Egyptologist, made several visits to Philadelphia. So we got off to a pretty good start. But I think what was most important for me in terms of development in the future were two things. I got involved with the idea of having exhibits about Egyptian material. Of course, there's a lot of Egyptian material at the Penn Museum, which is on display permanently. But the collection is huge. And so, you know, like 1% of it is on display and 99% is in storage. And a lot of it is very impressive. And so I got involved in the idea of developing exhibits. And so early on, we had one on Abydos itself. We had a division, almost the last major division. The Egyptians used to divide finds, artifacts, artworks that were made by a foreign-sponsored project, used to divide them between the Cairo Museum and the foreign institutions that were involved on that side. They've given up that policy now for quite a long time, which is a good idea to give it up. But I think we were the last major one that they did it with. So we had brought back a very large amount of material to Philadelphia, and we wanted to show that off as well. And so we did. We mounted quite a large exhibit on ancient Abydos, a major site we were working at, and using a lot of Abydos material we already had in storage, and then the newer material that had been given to us by the Egyptians. And we went on from there, and we had a fairly steady exhibit program, which was mostly due to the initiative of myself and then my colleagues as time went on. Lanny Bell, who was originally one of my students, became my associate in the program until he was enticed away by the Oriental Institute and became director of Chicago House. And then for many years, David Silverman and I worked together. And so being at Penn opened up interest and opportunities for exhibits. Maybe not quite the career thing to do so much, because really when they had to appoint me and promote me and so forth, this was all reviewed by committees that were very academic. So they were interested in teaching, research, publication, and I think exhibits were thought of as this somewhat flighty thing. But I got a lot out of it, and the public enjoyed it. They came along and liked it. And I guess for me, the jewel in the crown was an exhibit we put together on ancient Nubia, because we happen to have a very important Nubian collection as well. And that was one of the earliest traveling exhibits that the Penn Museum actually sponsored. And we got a big grant from, I've forgotten where, but some worthy government agency. And it went to 8 cities and was well received in all of them. Got reviewed in the New York Times. And so, you know, it was very successful. The other important thing for me then and in the future was the access to the storage collection. Which was totally assigned to the relative curator. And so that became a terribly important teaching tool for me. I could take groups of students down into the storage area, not the big undergraduate groups, just too numerous, but other more serious students, take them down to the storage area, sit them around a big long table, and if we were studying seals and scarabs, we could put out drawer after drawer after drawer of seals and scarabs from early dynastic times down to New Kingdom and late period material. And the same is true for everything else, ceramic tools, weapons, mortuary equipment. And so that really impressed me with the value of providing senior students, seriously interested students, with access to that kind of material. I think they've kept up that tradition at the University Museum, which I left in 1995, and but it really colored the way I operated with students. My main excavational concern or focus throughout the years I was at Penn and continuing on, even after I left it, is this fabulous site of Abydos in southern part of Middle Egypt, I guess you would describe it. Not so well known to the general public as places like Giza with its pyramids and Luxor with its still surviving temples. At Abydos, one very huge New Kingdom temple had survived, and a smaller one next to it. But the rest of the site was pretty much buried under debris and sand and things of this kind. So it was more of an enigmatic place. And when I got to the University Museum, the director, Frorini, said to me, "We want you to get out there in the field. Go find a site in Egypt that's important, and we'll sponsor and fund the excavation." And so I made up a kind of gazetteer of about 30, 35 sites throughout Egypt. And I spent a season in the field in Egypt, just going and looking at sites. Abydos was one, but there were many others, both in Middle Egypt and in the Delta. So I got a good idea of what the nature of Egyptian archaeology was at first hand. Because remember, up to this point, I'd been in Sudan and Nubia, which is a very distinctive and different place. And there were some sites that were still very impressive, or at least very intriguing. Abydos came under the category of very intriguing. And then there were others, and you thought, how could anyone do anything with this site, you know, sitting in the middle of a village in the Delta or something like that. So it was a very good introduction to what Egyptian archaeology would have to be all about. And of course, excavators have been working in Egypt for a very long period. Foreign excavators as well as Egyptian ones. But for me, this was all very new. And Abydos, when I came back home and had to write it all up and then make a suggestion or recommendation to the Penn Museum, Abydos just emerged at the top of the pile. And I think I was honest about the reasons that I presented. I felt there had been many early excavations at Abydos, so we knew a lot about it archaeologically, but the site presented lots of difficulties for excavators. And secondly, those early excavators really did go back to the end of the 19th century and through the early years of the 20th century, and their work was more intriguing than revealing. So they opened up all different parts of the site and indicated there's something important here and here and here. But then their presentation of what they did and what they found was often, you couldn't get a grip on what it is they were working with. So there was that idea that there's a lot to do there. And secondly, I thought it was very important that the nature of the remains at Abydos were tremendously varied. And there are temples, for sure, and other cultic structures all over the place. There are vast cemeteries, which has always been a happy hunting ground for Egyptologists because they're relatively easy to excavate, and you get things that are intact sometimes. So there were many cemetery sites. But there were town sites. There was actually the remains of a very large town site. And so what attracted me most to it was the fact that you've got this range of different site types, many different periods represented, intriguing possibilities opened up by earlier excavations, and the sense that if we followed up on them, we would learn much more than they learned about these places. All of that was impelling me towards the Abydos. There are other sites that sometimes fitted into these categories, but I didn't see any of them that had the range and the accessibility of Abydos. And then there is, I think, a third factor that I didn't mention in my recommendation, but that is the site looked like Buhen, with its low desert location, its very rich archaeology, and then the distant cliffs rising behind it. So I think there was a certain affinity there that helped me to make up my mind. And it was interesting because at Buchen, Emery and his team lived in a mud brick house, which had actually been built by people from the Penn Museum. Many, many years ago, Penn had sponsored an excavation a whole series of excavations in Nubia. One of the participants was Randall McIver, who was a well-known archaeologist of the day, and the other was Leonard Woolley. Before he became the excavator of ancient Ur, he excavated ancient Buchen, amongst other places. And they built a house of a rather distinctive style there. And at Abydos, we had to build a house too because the villagers didn't offer any appropriate accommodation. And it emerged looking very like the Buchen house. So that experience at Buchen had strong implications for me. In any case, the rest, I suppose, is history, because we worked at Abydos and still work at Abydos for many, many years. We began excavations in 1967, and here we are in 2016, and we're still working at Abydos in the same concession. So you know it's a very rich site if it keeps us busy. The other thing that was influenced by my position and experiences at the Penn Museum was that as we settled into the northern part of Abydos, because the Egyptian authority, I originally asked for all of Abydos, what is that, 5 kilometers of archaeology? And they said, well, they were very nice about all this. They said, well, that's a lot. Why don't you focus in on one part of the site? And so I asked for North Abydos, which is actually a very large concession, which is what they called it in those days. And so there were many parts of Abydos that I was not working with directly. We knew about from earlier excavations. But here was I, as a relatively young student scholar, I come to Penn, the Penn Museum, and the Penn Museum said, you're qualified, go into the field. Find this an interesting site. I'd done that, and I thought, as time went on, I thought, now, if we get a lot of good students at Penn, there's, you know, 2/3 of Abydos isn't covered. Let's see if we can encourage some of them to take up work of their own at these different parts of Abydos. And so that worked out very well. There were such students, and with my encouragement, once they had achieved their qualifications and finished their PhDs, they applied for concessions, permits to excavate other parts of Abydos, and they got them, and they are all still working there. So everybody is stuck. And the results have been terrific. I covered them in my recent book, a little commercial here, but that summarizes it up to 5 or 6 years ago, and there's already a lot of new material to add to the record. But what was important to me was to create that cadre of young scholars who were ready to take up these challenges and these projects, and I was modeling it at what happened to me. But if the Penn Museum trusted me, I'll trust them to do the right thing and run successful projects, and they did. The United States aid grants were available for conservation. And so that opened up the opportunity of thinking seriously about conservation at Abydos. And within the part of Abydos that we were responsible for, the major monument that survived was a huge mud brick structure about the size of a New York City block, so really big. Not a building, though. It's a great enclosure with mud brick walls, a small structure within it, and otherwise very empty space. But it had been looked at before, inscriptions had been found, and we knew that it belonged to the last king of the Second Dynasty. So a very early monument that tied in with other important early Egyptian materials at Abydos. The kings of the first and some of the second dynasties had actually been buried at a site way back in the desert. And these big brick enclosures, of which this was the surviving example, were somehow connected to all of that early ceremonial activity with early kings. And we had studied parts of this monument and actually other enclosures like it that were much less well preserved, and learned quite a lot more about their function and significance to the early Egyptians. But it was clear that the great enclosure that still rose about 30 feet high, so relatively well preserved, suffered from a lot of problems that threatened its stability and its continuity. It had lasted for about 5,000 years, but it was not clear that it would go much longer than that. It has all kinds of problems. It had been reused as a Coptic monastery, Christian monastery later in its history, and they had dug big holes in the walls in order to place cells in them. And then there were the vicious attacks of wasps, who love to build huge nests in the wall. And the trouble is, when they do that, they undercut that part of the wall, and eventually it falls off. And so there were the wasps and many other things, and lots of little birds, sparrows, I suppose, which lived in the walls and dug their little nests in there. They chatted all day long while we were working there, bird song, until one day I was out there in the enclosure and I suddenly realized it was deadly quiet. No birds were singing. What the heck happened? I looked up and there was a hawk circling the enclosure, seeing if there was a breakfast ready for him. And all these hundreds of birds just shut up. Amazing. Anyway, with these USAID grants possible, we applied for several, plus some other support, and we undertook the conservation and stabilization of this rugged, ill-treated monument. We think we can guarantee, if our work is concluded, another 5,000 years of being there at least. And the net result is we have done about a bit over 50% has been stabilized and conserved. We're not trying to restore the original appearance. We're preserving it as it is, this rugged remnant of early times. And we are still working on raising funds to complete the other approximate 50% that needs to be done. So it's true that at Malgana, I didn't want to get involved in conservation and things like that. We left the site undisturbed. But at Abydos, we had this long-term commitment. The opportunity for funding came up, so we felt we should really follow up on that. One of the very satisfying things about working at Penn was the quality of the students who came and those who chose to be specialized in Egyptology. That gave us the capacity to encourage them to develop their own projects at Abydos, which they have done. And so throughout those years at Penn, from 64 to 1995, I was busily teaching different generations of students and also a larger student body interested in Egypt and hearing about it. And people ask me, and they say, you must be a good teacher to have brought all those students there. And so many of them went on to get degrees in Egyptology and got out in the field and all the rest of it. And I say, yes, I must have been. But I actually have no idea. You ask me, what's your philosophy of teaching? What ideas did you have? I just thought, I want to talk about ancient Egypt. And I want to talk about what intrigues me about it and all the things I discover about it. And at the same time, give people a good grounding in basic areas like Egyptian archaeology, Egyptian art history. My colleague, faculty member, you normally taught the language, so that was covered by them. But I don't know. I think you need to talk to my former students and ask them what was it? Because what I remember is the enthusiasm with which I tackled the topic. That I remember. But what aspects of the way I presented material and ideas resonated with people, it's not clear to me. I think one of my greatest experiences, both at the Penn Museum and the University of Pennsylvania, and then later at the Institute of Fine Arts of New York University, where I went for another 20-odd years or so, I think really working with students who were dedicated to the study of ancient Egypt in many different fields, and who were really and are really quite brilliant people. That was a very rewarding experience for me to be working with students of that caliber. And that's true both at the Penn Museum and then later at the Institute of Fine Arts. And I think if you said, well, if you want to rank your achievements in some kind of way, those very successful students would be first. All these other things I've talked about are obviously very important and very significant for me, but the student experience really counts for me. And I'm glad to say that many of them have developed quite good careers since then. Some of them are curators in the Egyptian department at the Metropolitan Museum. Others are at major universities like Penn, Michigan, Brown, Toronto, some other places that I can't recall right now. And I did have one particularly interesting student that would be well known to the general public interested in ancient Egypt, and that's Zahi Hawass, who got a Fulbright fellowship. He worked with me at Abydos for one season. He was the inspector assigned to represent the antiquities organization on site. Every project has its Egyptian inspector who was there to represent the interests of the Ministry of Antiquities as it is now, or the antiquities organizations in earlier days. And so we met a lot of our Egyptian colleagues that way, and Zahi was there for one season as a fairly junior inspector. And then he got a Fulbright and opted to come to Penn and study with me and my colleague David Silverman. And he was really a model student. He didn't want any concessions made to him. He worked very hard, both at taking courses, which is what you have to do with an American PhD degree, and then developing a thesis topic and writing it up. And it was on Giza because he was very interested in that. So he wrote a very good dissertation and got his degree and went back to Egypt. And he was on leave, I guess, from the Antiquities Organization and took up positions in the Antiquities Organization again. And is well known, he eventually rose to the level of being in charge of the Antiquities Organization. And so we still saw a great deal of each other. I was coming out to Egypt to work, and he liked to get together with me. And that was a very warm friendship that has persisted to this day. During his tenure as person in charge of the Antiquities Organization, he made terrific changes. He secured much better funding from the Egyptian government for the Antiquities Organization. He upgraded the status and the benefits of the staff, the inspectors and other people who were spread throughout Egypt. It's a very large organization. Sought and encouraged foreign-sponsored projects to create field schools for Egyptian inspectors, archaeological field schools. And he took a very great interest in making sites even more accessible to tourists than they had been before, and with a lot of enhancement of the, not just the external appearance, but also he solicited advice and contributions as to their stability. Like the Great Temple of Karnak has a very serious problem, as do other monuments in Thebes, with underground water, which both weakens the foundations and also creates salts which penetrate up into the stonework and damage the reliefs and so forth and so on. And there were certainly institutions ready to help out with this, but Zahi was very supportive of these initiatives. So now there is a whole subsurface draining system in the monumental zone at Thebes, which has improved the stability of the monuments a great deal. So he achieved a great deal. I mean, I have lived through many heads of antiquities organization in Egypt, and they've always been cooperative and thoughtful, while, you know, insisting on people following the regulations and the protocol that's required if you want to excavate in Egypt. So I was, you know, always impressed by the person in charge, but Zahi really elevated it to a new plateau. And I think, although he's retired now and conditions in Egypt are a bit difficult for the antiquities organization and everyone else, I'm sure eventually that will stabilize out. I should mention, though, that even things are difficult for the Egyptian government and the Egyptian population as a whole, their hospitality towards foreign-sponsored projects is still completely the same. Projects like ours and all the others I know of all can secure their permission to carry out their work, and with the full cooperation of the what is now the Ministry of Antiquities. Now, I didn't work only at Abydos, Buhen first and then Abydos, although Abydos has become a long-term commitment. But in the 70s, in the early 70s, there were a couple of security concerns in Egypt. There was some penetration of their frontiers, not near Abydos specifically, but penetration of their frontiers, and the security part of the government got very concerned about this. And so they decided that for a while they would like foreign projects with their exotic members to be concentrated at two or three major sites. One was Thebes, one was Giza and Saqqara, but places like Abydos were put made out of bounds. So we couldn't work there. And we looked for alternative sites. I was intrigued at Thebes by, on the one hand, actually the whole issue of the tombs of the 17th dynasty pharaohs, the small pyramidal tombs of 17th dynasty pharaohs, which are on the west bank of Thebes, which were discovered, some of them, by Mariette and others, and then lost, very careless of everybody. They were small, they were badly preserved, and so they were reported on, and people literally couldn't tell you where is the pyramid of King X and Y and so forth. Since then, we didn't take that up, but it would have been interesting. Since then, much later, Daniel Pultz of the German Archaeological Institute has taken up the site, discovered another one of these pyramids, and is continuing to make important discoveries there. So the other place that I looked at, because I was very interested in urban life, urban settlements, and palatial structures, which have all not received as much attention in Egypt as they should have. There are important exceptions to that, but it's still true. And so Malgada, which is a great palatial site at Thebes, which had been worked on by the Metropolitan Museum of Art earlier on, there was, again, still many issues to look at there. So we asked for permission to excavate there and received it. And there I collaborated with Barry Kemp, who I'd known at Cambridge. And we had a co-directed project that went on for several seasons. And we made some interesting discoveries. One was looking at the great artificial lake that the Egyptians had created right next to the palace. We ended up with a better understanding how that developed by looking at the great mounds of spoil that were thrown up around the site. We did not work that much in the actual palace site itself, the architecture. That had been exposed by the Metropolitan Museum. We knew there were the remains of painted surfaces that had collapsed into the ruins. And the last thing I wanted to get involved in was a conservation project. There's something ironic about that, but I'll come back to that in a minute. So we left the palatial site pretty much alone. We did, however, collect a huge amount of ceramic of the period. And we had Colin Hope working with us, who was a terrific ceramicist. And so that was an important resource, maybe not so exciting to the general public, but very important as a very large and varied sample that came from, a well-documented site. I like to mention there was one sherd of Mycenaean ware there. Most people would say, what the heck is they doing there? But the interesting thing was at Amarna, the next generation, with Akhenaten. The Malgada belonged to Amenhotep III, and then his son was Akhenaten, who set up a new city at Amarna. And Amarna is drenched in Mycenaean material as well as much else. So it was very interesting to see that sharp break and yet this one little fissure in it. So it was a great experience, but we didn't anticipate a long-term stay there. And so when the security concerns eased and other sites became available again, we proposed to continue with our work at Abydos and got permission to do that and have lived through everything ever since. The terrible assassination of President Sadat took place while we were out there at Abydos. Nothing untoward happened to us or has ever happened to us. Been involved now in Egyptian archaeology for quite a long time. So one might wonder what kind of changes have taken place in the practice of archaeology in Egypt, field archaeology. And there have been changes in some ways, and in other ways it's got a kind of continuing tradition. If you walked on to the site of Abydos, when we were there one day working, you would see site supervisors overlooking the work. You would see a large group of local workmen and also smaller groups of specialist workmen, local workmen from the surrounding villages, specialist workmen coming from another part of Egypt where there's a tradition of archaeological work for projects. You would think you were looking at a Petri excavation way back in the early years of the 20th century. So that's the continuing part of what's going on. But what it says is there are certain ways of doing things in Egypt that are good. They work well with the conditions. So even today, you have these lines of older boys carrying the spoil away from the excavation and dumping it. When I started, everyone used baskets. And then there was a daring innovation of using small metal buckets, for which continues. The specialist workmen are very good. The rest of the workforce is good at what it does. We've had a series of very good foremen over time who each been with us for many, many years and are kind of leaders of the workforce. These are just conditions that continue. On the other hand, there have been major changes and innovations. Technology is now deployed to very great effect for archaeology in Egypt. This includes much enhanced surveying technology. can do a lot much. You can do a great deal more with mapping a site, mapping remains, and so forth, and also subsurface technology that actually enables you to see what's in areas which have not been excavated. This has been really dramatic at Abydos, because out there in the desert there are these huge cemetery fields with chapels set above them, and then larger structures interspersed with them, including very early ones. And many of these, we had no idea that these were just great expanses of sand on the site. And then Thomas Herbeck, who is our subsurface consultant, went over much of the site, and you can just see the layer of the whole archaeology. You can see it. In a way, you could say, let's not touch it. But it does enables you to be very much better about your selection of where you will work. Actually, several more early remains that are quite important were located through the subsurface survey, not any other way. So there have been, from the point of view of technology, that's much enhanced Egyptian archaeology, but there are certain ways of doing things that really go back a long way, but are really still quite helpful to follow. Well, after many years at Penn, I was offered a position at the Institute of Fine Arts of New York University, which was originally set up for and held by a very distinguished historian of Egyptian art, Bernard Hoffman, who unfortunately had died around about the time that I was not nearing an end of my career at Penn, but was feeling, much as I'd enjoyed Penn and much as it had been a great benefit for me, I think I was thinking about some kind of a change. They advertised the position that was left vacant by Bernard Bothmer's death. It has a wonderfully grandiose tone to it. It's the Lila Atchison Wallace Professorship of Ancient Egyptian Art. Mrs. Wallace was the widow of the founder of Reader's Digest. And so she was a very well-off lady. And she was, she knew Bernard Bothmer, and she was keen to support research, especially if it involved him. And when he retired from the Brooklyn Museum, where he was the leading curator for many years, the suggestion was made that he could be given a teaching appointment at the Institute of Fine Arts. And well, all these positions have to be endowed. And so Mrs. Wallace endowed it with an endowment that would pay the salary and the benefits and be a bit more than that. And she gave it, not in cash, but in Reader Digest stock. And I think it was valued at $700,000+ when it was set up. And within a certain space of time, it had gone into millions of dollars. Reader Digest stock was hot stock to have, and its value increased tremendously. And even better, the Institute's Board of, Board of Governors, I can't remember, sold it right before Reader's Digest stock started to go down. And you would have lost value. So there was a big resource there, the record set up by Bernard Bothmer and the endowment. When they advertised the position to fill Bothmer's position, I've forgotten whether they contacted me or I contacted them, but we were in contact, and they were interested to see me applying for the job. They had a number of distinguished people applying for the position, and I thought it was a bit of a long shot, because although I dealt a lot with Egyptian art, I hadn't really been trained as an art historian of Egyptian art. But I applied and went and gave a talk and had an interview and so forth and so on. And then a little bit to my surprise, they picked me. And there were other people at I thought, you know, were very likely candidates for this position. But it turned out the Institute was interested in the fact that I had an archaeological project going, that I wasn't, I mean, I didn't only deal with art and archaeology and so forth, but I had a project. It was a bit of a change for me. The biggest change was that we didn't have our own collection at the IFA. So my whole business of taking the senior students in to work with the collections and so forth really wasn't feasible there. On the other hand, one block away, we had the Metropolitan Museum of Art that has one of the, you know, grandest collections of Egyptian art ever, which is all on display. They have total display policy. So whenever we were dealing with material that was in the Institute of in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, I could tell people, go over to Gallery A, Gallery X, or whatever it was, and spend some time there, make repeated visits there, and learn from the material that's available. So to some degree, that compensated for not actually having a collection anymore. But with the support of the Institute, we were able to continue our project at Abydos. We supplemented, they provided a regular stipend to run the project or maintain the project. And we sought and we gained a number of important grants, the USAID and others that have kept us going since then. So it was an interesting change of venue, but things that were important to me were still accessible in that setup. Another important environs that I've functioned with as an Egyptologist is the American Research Center in Egypt, which is now a long established, I think it was set up in the 40s sometime, a long established umbrella organization for most Egyptologically oriented activity. Especially activity in Egypt with excavations, epigraphic work, conservation work. The American Research Center serves as an umbrella organization to facilitate all these institutions and projects which are operating out from the United States into Egypt. And so it's a kind of US-wide assemblage of all the institutions and people who are interested in ancient Egypt. So it's got a great public following as well as an academic following. I've been a member of it, of course, for a long time and long associated with it and has lived through many of its crises and recurrent regaining of stability and funding and so forth. And for a period, I was one of their presidents every year, or not every year, that's presidents are elected on a three-year basis. So that was an interesting experience as well. So I think really the center is a major resource for archaeological, Egyptological research related to the activities of U.S. institutions, that it's been a great benefit to Egypt as well, particularly since it has been able to, the American Research Center in Egypt has been able to acquire a lot of major funding for conservation. I've talked about our conservation efforts, other people have conservation efforts, but the American Research Center in Egypt is able to operate on a scale of conservation, which far outstrips the efforts of any individual project. So it's been interesting and exciting to be part of that as well, which seems to have a future ahead of it as well. The USAID seems quite taken up with what the Research Center has achieved in that area, and it looks like they're willing to continue to support initiatives of that kind. And it's also been great because we have an annual get-together in various parts of the U.S., and I get to see all my colleagues. I mean, we're spread right across the face of the United States, and it's really very pleasant and exciting to be together, all together, and see people that maybe you haven't seen for months or a year or whatever, but you know you're guaranteed to see them there. So it's a very important part of the US-sponsored initiatives in Egypt, but it's also a great boon for the discipline in the States as a whole. So I suppose it would be good to talk a little bit about my own research and the kind of expression that it has found. I do feel that I made significant contributions to Egyptological research in the form of the various articles, the many articles I've published over the years, also books that I've authored or co-edited, of which there are a number. I guess the ones that are most significant for me is a book I published on ancient Nubia called Ancient Nubia, Egypt's Rival in Africa, a contribution to the Cambridge, they called it Ancient Egypt, a Social History, which was one of the earlier publications. Bruce Trigger contributed to it, Barry Kemp contributed to it, Alan Lloyd contributed to it. I think it was one of the earlier publications that that did kind of highlight approaches to the ancient Egyptian society and economy as distinct from a chronicle of events, which histories of Egypt often tended to be. So I think it was there have been a lot of publications since then that take these broader perspectives, but I think Ancient Egypt, a Social History was one of them. And finally, a recent publication that was a pleasure for me was a publication called The Old Kingdom Town at Buhen. Emery's work at Buhen encompassed mostly Middle Kingdom and New Kingdom material. But in one of the seasons that I was there, much to our surprise, we discovered, not at the great Middle Kingdom monuments there, but some distance away, an ancient Egyptian town site in the heart of early Nubia. And this had never been found before, so it was rather an exciting discovery. And we spent a full season on it, and a little bit more in another season. And then Emery continued with his work. He went to Saqqara, worked on early monuments there again. At some point after he died, I was asked by the Egypt Exploration Society if I would prepare the Old Kingdom Town records for publication. And I did. It was, you know, an honor to be asked to do it, and I enjoyed doing it. It was challenging because the archaeology was complicated. And Emery had a very basic system of recording, which was valuable, but we would probably have done it a bit differently today. And so you had to kind of look at his ongoing recording of the site and then site supervisors' ongoing recordings. A lot of different bits of the process had to be pulled together. Egypt Exploration Society is a busy place with many publications. And it took quite a long time for them to reach that particular publication, but it came out in 2014, a mere 50 years, I think, after the excavation. Pretty good for Egyptological research. And I was very happy and proud to have done that. Now, I retired, actually, from the Institute of Fine Arts just this year. I have to think of what to do with myself now that I'm not teaching students, although I'm still supervising PhD candidates. And that's a good experience that's continuing. They're doing some really interesting work. But the question is, what do I want to do? Well, there are lots of aspects of our work at Abydos that need to be published. And the one that perhaps interests me most is a collection of cultic chapels of the Middle Kingdom, which everyone in Egyptology knew about these because they're referred to in surviving texts. But nobody had ever seen one, I think it's fair to say. And just by luck, when we were excavating actually New Kingdom monument, which is pretty destroyed, we discovered that under it was a group of these mysterious Middle Kingdom structures, actually in very good shape because someone had built a temple on top of them and nobody ever got through the floor of the temple. Well, they did get through some of it, but a lot of it they didn't. And These are very intriguing monuments. We have a very complete record of them now. And I've published articles on them, but I'd like to bring out the full publication of those in particular. Then there are other aspects of Abydos that need to be, especially early aspects that need to be worked on. That I'll do in collaboration with my colleague, Matthew Adams, former student of mine, who has now become associate director and field director of the Our Abydos project. So that's continuing on generating material. But outside of Abydos proper, I have a book on the foreigner's depiction of the foreigner in ancient Egyptian art, which is kind of a first. I mean, there isn't any such book. There are lots of articles, but no such book. And it's completed, and now it's being considered for publication, and I hope will be out sometime in the near future. There's a book I've been wanting to write up for a long time, and it's called Sidious Cosmos in Ancient Egypt, which is a bit of a debatable topic, but I think there's a case to be made for reading the remains and the purposes of ancient Egyptian cities and towns as relating to their cosmological beliefs, as well as many other factors, social factors, technical factors, all of this kind of stuff, but that there's this overarching concept of the Egyptian cosmos and how it functioned and how it's reflected in all levels of activity and nature and human habitations, all these kinds of things. And so that book is kind of probably the major project for the next future, immediate future, let me put it that way. And otherwise, let's see what happens. Something interesting always happens when you're doing Egyptological research, so I'm feeling reasonably optimistic. I suppose it would be good to think a little bit about what's the future of Egyptology, and maybe especially Egyptological research in Egypt itself. I think Egyptology is well established as a recognized field in the US and indeed the international academic world. There are a good number of important centers of Egyptological training and research in the States. If you look at Europe, there is another great number of them there. And then you have other places that sponsor excavation in Egypt. So I think that as an academic discipline, Egyptology is rather strongly secure for the future. There's also a big popular interest in ancient Egypt, which is another thing to pay attention to, because first of all, the interest is a serious one and you want to respond to it. And secondly, it's important to funding agencies to be able to present records that show that you don't just do arcane research work, but you also meet the public interest in ancient Egypt in a well-informed way. Now, if you turn to Egypt itself, I think the model for excavation in Egypt is changing. I've mentioned the fact that there are new technologies of survey, subsurface survey, in many other ways, also enhanced conservation technologies that are now deployed in archaeological and epigraphic and art historical fieldwork in Egypt. If we look at US-sponsored and other sponsored work in Egypt itself, however, I think change is going on. There are these new technologies which are being deployed in research, and that's good. But the big change, I think, is going to be in our relationships with our Egyptian colleagues. Egypt has long had an antiquities organization under various names to protect and maintain the monuments and the archaeology of Egypt, and to encourage the exploration of that archaeology. In fact, Egypt was the second country in the world to set up a government organization dedicated to the archaeological and monumental remains of their culture. The earliest one was Greek, and then Egypt, and then everybody came along. John didn't come lately, as it were. So it's not that Egypt has not paid a lot of attention to its monuments throughout modern history. But you have these two groups working in Egyptian archaeology. You have the foreign-sponsored projects, which I know the Egyptians appreciate what they bring in terms of the knowledge they acquire, the conservation projects that they set up, and so forth. But at the same time, you have a very large antiquities organization structure with museum curators, inspectors who work in the field and administer the different regions of Egypt, and a central office that runs this whole thing and maintains the funding and all the rest of it. And I think increasingly, and these two setups tended to operate independently of each other. The foreign projects had to, of course, apply for permission to work and to have representatives of the antiquities organization present while their excavations are carried on. But otherwise, they kind of followed their own line of direction work. And then the Egyptian colleagues, some academics in universities who taught Egyptology, others who were members of the various antiquities organization systems, we're involved in fieldwork of their own. Academic Egyptologists from Egyptian universities set up projects, just as foreign institutions did, and inspectors were charged with not just maintaining the conservation of monuments, but also protecting sites from plundering and disturbance. And often had to carry out excavations of their own, sometimes for salvage reasons, sometimes because an inspectorate felt it would be good to open up an area around a monument or whatever. And so that was another line of work that was going on. What I feel is now happening, there are two things really that the future needs. One is already happening, and that is a much greater interaction between the foreign-sponsored projects and the Ministry of Antiquities. And our Egyptian colleagues, especially the ones in the Ministry of Antiquities, have got a very strong interest in ensuring that they are up to date on techniques, theoretical issues, all the kind of things that are important in looking at ancient archaeological remains. And they're interested in learning archaeological practice and ideas that are up to date. And so we're seeing much greater interaction between the foreign-sponsored projects and what is now the Ministry of Antiquities, with foreign projects and the American Research Center in Egypt sponsoring field schools, conservation schools, setting up conservation labs. But it's all for the benefit of Egyptians who will ultimately take over those developments. And at the same time, I think there's a sense that Egyptian archaeology should be more the province of the Egyptians. They've been extremely hospitable and collaborative with foreign research, sponsored research into Egypt, and I'm sure they're going to continue to do that. I think that the mode in which that operates may change. And you may see more kind of collaborative foreign institution and Egyptian Ministry of Antiquities collaboration, which I think would be a good thing. And the other important thing is the interests of the Egyptian population at large in their archaeology. In a way, they know about all its major features, and they're very proud of it. Of course, you know, Tutankhamun's tomb, the pyramids, these are world famous aspects of archaeology, and they're seen as part of the image of Egypt. But it's mostly the educated upper classes that are particularly aware of that. The larger population, the workers, the artisans, the farmers, of course, are aware of the monuments and aware of archaeology, but our sense is that in many parts of Egypt, they don't have a strong sense of what all this means to the national image and to preserving monuments and covering archaeological remains that are significant. And I think American Egyptology, like other Egyptologies, ought to be contributing and are contributing to both of these issues, closer collaboration with Egyptological colleagues. And on the other hand, also, although it's much in its initial stages, and again, it's something that can only be done in collaboration with the Ministry of Antiquities, raising local regional consciousnesses about the monuments and the sites that are in their particular area that they may know very well, that they may see every time they walk out of their house or when they drive up to the next village. They go through places that you can see are archaeological, but often they don't have any very clear idea of what all this means. So I think there's a big public education undertaking that could be taken. It isn't as if ancient Egypt is not taught on a wide span in Egypt. It is. Kids are taught about it in school. So it's not like people are unaware of what's going on. But it is still true, I think, that the larger population's understanding of what's going on and why the sites are significant would benefit from some concerted effort on the part of foreign projects, working closely though with the Ministry of Antiquities, who would really be in control of any such initiative. So that's the kind of future I see ahead for Egyptology. I think it's a good future. I think it's going to change in important ways, but I think that's part of the goodness that we're looking at.